Tonight's edition of Thames Debate, which is about Britain's relationship with the rest of the common market, was recorded before the dramatic turnaround of Britain's budget contribution. However, this latest deal, which has won for Mrs. Thatcher a greater share of the cash loaf than she may dared have hoped for, is unlikely to end the tensions within the community. It has caused disquiet in France and deep unease in Germany. It is these deep-rooted tensions which are reflected in tonight's debate, which asks, are the British bad Europeans? Hello, good evening and welcome to Thames Debate, the last of the present series from the Ironmongers' Hall in the City of London. The most passionate common marketeer, and despite everything, such folks still exist, would be hard put to deny that Britain's relations with the rest of the community leave something to be desired. Nor can there be great hope that next week's Venice summit will resolve all the problems. The French reject our sheep meat, which is lamb in EEC clothing, are bombarding us with apples that some say taste of undernourished cotton wool. The Germans are reported exasperated by Mrs. Thatcher's refusal to accept their compromise on Britain's budget contribution. And everyone is left in the lurch after Lord Carrington's gaffe over trade sanctions against Iran. So, is it all our fault? Are the British bad Europeans? Jean-Claude Servan-Schreiber, a member of the Gaullist Party, which it has to be said, is not renowned for lending a sympathetic ear to Britain's special problems, thinks that we are. Geoffrey Rippon, Tory MP, former leader of the Conservative group at the European Parliament, and who helped to negotiate our original entry, most definitely does not. In our audience, a cross-section, in more senses of one, I think we shall discover, of British and mainland European opinion. Are the British bad Europeans? Mrs. Servan-Schreiber, you have 5 minutes.
Well, let me first of all make a short statement. I do not intend to be aggressive or especially critical. I love this country for many reasons. I was partially educated in one of your universities, the best, of course. And being a Frenchman who was in Dunkirk in 1940 and served in the resistance and the French armored divisions afterwards, I shall never forget that England stood alone in those very dark years, and you helped the whole of Europe to conquer back its liberty. But this being said, to the question, do the British make bad Europeans? My answer is yes, they are not Europeans at all. Of course, we are all, more or less, the products of the same sort of civilization. And there is no difference between the men who built the cathedrals of Cracovia in Poland, or Aachen in Germany, or Reims in France, or Canterbury here. But as a nation, as a collectivity, you, the British, have for four centuries now been living under a totally different principle to all other European nations. Your lines of interest are across the seas, and there is no reason why it should change. I'll tell you, if I were British, I would not be European, and would certainly continue to steer a straight course away from the continent. In fact, you are the Greeks of the Imperial American Republic. How do we stand today? We have signed in 1958 the Treaty of Rome, first effort to build Europe, or at least a community of nations, which could become eventually a basis for ultimate and wider European community. It is more than a simple club. It is an economic community with all its consequences on our habits, customs, and national sovereignties. We are responsible members of Europe, and we always had difficulties with your country because of basic differences in habits, customs, and psychology. In 1962, General de Gaulle said that you were not ready to join our community because of the special links that you always had with another nation who obviously is not European, never will be, and does not wish to become. 10 years later, In 1972, Georges Pompidou, President of the Republic at the time, yielded to various pressures, and you became members of the EEC. I say that we have not behaved as responsible Europeans by accepting you. Your commercial circuits, trade links, are incompatible with the common market. Let's not go into many details. The debate will probably show them up. Take only one example, milk and butter. You buy half of it inside EEC, the other half in New Zealand. Now, it is your perfect right to do so, according to the treaty. But you must pay for each imported pound the difference between the price that you buy it from New Zealand and the price it is sold inside Europe, which is higher. So the more you import butter or milk, the more you pay to the community. This is the accepted rule. You must prefer goods from inside EEC to any other goods, or else it is just a free trade zone. We understand that you want to privilege certain countries, as New Zealand, who buys cars from you and sells you butter in exchange. It is your right, but you must accept to pay. Your real fundamental calculation is that you will win by destroying the common market, but there you are deeply mistaken. We are now 200 million Europeans, and our gross national product is 40% higher than that of the British. We will not withdraw. Your calculation is a short-term one. Exchange between rich people is part of our form of prosperity. 38% of our exchanges both ways are with Germany. I'm afraid that you're turning your backs to the solution that we propose. But you have no sense of what is a European community. And I think your public opinion is victim of your trade unions and your press. It is demagogical in sense of international responsibility. We are under the impression that you, the British, still behave as a great 19th century power and have no sense of the spirit of the present European club. The question of this debate should be, does England really want Europe? Where the first six built up this EEC, there was no negotiation after the signing. We all had to move forward, and that was it. You have already asked for three renegotiations. When you join a club, you don't renegotiate the terms of the club. If they do not suit you, you get yourself another club.
There, I must stop you, sir. Thank you very much indeed. Mr. Geoffrey Rippon, you two have 5 minutes.
Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, we've listened to a speech which, of course, started off with the wrong premise. The motion is the British are bad Europeans. The motion accepts what is the truth, namely that we are Europeans. And it's really no good starting this debate by suggesting we're not Europeans at all. By geography and by history, we are Europeans. Nor is it any good arguing any longer that our lines of interest are across the seas. Of course, we in Britain have lines of interest right across the seas. But if we defended our empire in the Himalayas, we have always defended ourselves in Europe. And my argument is not that we are bad Europeans, we're good Europeans. Indeed, I would say in this century, and it follows from the introductory remarks which we've just listened to, in this century, we're the best Europeans. Twice in this century, we in Britain have played our part in the defense of freedom in Europe. Always we in Britain have played a role in Europe with allies in defense of the free nations against whoever might seek to dominate the continent of Europe. Whether it was France under Napoleon, Germany under the Kaiser, or under Hitler, and now the Soviet Union. So we are, in every sense, good Europeans. and we stand for the right sort of Europe. We're talking about the spirit of Europe. What sort of Europe is it that we seek to create? We in Britain have in mind the Europe for which Churchill spoke after the war. A Europe, he said, in which we would be able to move about freely, in which everyone would feel at home. A Europe which Ernest Bevin once said he wanted to go to Victoria Station and take a train to where the hell he likes. A free Europe, a democratic Europe, a wider Europe, a Europe from the Iberian Peninsula to Finland, in which countries like Austria and Scandinavia, with historic neutrality, or in the case of Austria, neutrality by treaty, would be very closely associated, even if not part of the European community. I regret very much that we didn't join from the outset the Treaty of Rome. I think that would have been easier for us. We had to join a moving train, but we joined the moving train at the invitation of the community. It was President Pompidou, as we've heard, who unlocked the door. And I certainly found no difficulty in negotiating with the French government at that time. It was, in many ways, much easier to deal with than some of the others, if I may say so with respect. And although there have been what have been called renegotiations, it's only the sort of renegotiation that takes part in a living community every year. The basic treaty of accession, which I signed in Brussels with Mr. Heath and Alec Douglas-Hume, the treaty of accession remains intact, and we are complying with it. And my argument would certainly be that at the present time, it is the other members of the community who are not responding to the spirit of the treaty of accession, where we agreed between us that we couldn't have a budget 6 years ahead. In our own country, we sometimes have two or three national budgets a year, that the community budget would have to be considered each year, that the size and shape of the budget would change, and new elements would be introduced into it. And we also agreed that if unacceptable situations should arise, it would be the duty of the European institutions to deal with them. Now, it can't be right in a community such as we have at present that only one nation should be expected to make a net contribution, because most of the budget goes on only one thing, agriculture, and we in Britain have the smallest proportion of our population in agriculture. But that is the small change. What I am really saying is this, that the British, by history, in this century and more recently, have demonstrated that what we want is a Europe in which Britain will play a full part, and which all the countries who are in Europe understand that unless we are united, we cannot have the security and the prosperity that we would otherwise enjoy.